So let's get into today's topic. And the topic for tonight is, what is Islam doing in the West? What is Islam doing in the West? The West has had a real problem because there is a movement here in these countries, and I would say it's not just here, it's also all over Europe, of trying to create a multicultural ideal. Western governments want assimilation. They don't want to have exclusivity. They want integration. Western governments are trying to seek for acceptance of all cultural and ethnic differences, and so they're looking for this social cohesion, and of course for many years now this multiculturalism has been the answer to that. The difficulty with multiculturalism is it works fine providing everybody integrates, providing everybody assimilates, providing there is not any group that tries or has its own agenda. And there has always been a problem in Europe because there has always been one group that has never assimilated, and that has always been Islam. And I don't mind saying that, and I say that publicly all the time. For those of you who don't know, I'm down at Speaker's Corner every Sunday when I'm in country. We have a whole team that goes down, gets up on ladders, and we confront Islam publicly at Speaker's Corner, not too far from here. If any of you are free, come on down and join us. We'd love to have you. And we do say very clearly that Islam is probably the only faith, the only religion today that is incapable of assimilating. It has not been able to integrate. And we'll unpack a little bit of that more tonight. Muslims do confront those who confront it, and they usually call me Islamophobic. You've probably, those of you who have had to engage with Islam critically, will be called Islamophobic. They consider it to be the primary sin of Europe. They would say that they are not to belong to Europe. They would like to see themselves in parallel communities. Their leadership seeks to influence Europe's political fabric, culturally, the education, the economy, and the media. And we'll see exactly where that goes later on tonight. How are they doing this? Well, they use the democracy, the whole democratic process, to then bring in the tolerance that is evoked by the democratic process to bring in their intolerance. Imposing laws to stifle criticism, like the incitement to religious hatred law. Claiming territory for themselves, like Ibn Ibzidin a number of years ago. Maybe you saw what he did there in Walthamstow, where he claimed that as their land. Infiltrating schools to introduce Islamic teaching. We saw this with the Trojan horse scandal that happened in Birmingham, where they were introducing an awful lot of their teaching in those schools. And, of course, finally, creating enclaves using Sharia law. And we are now aware of what's happening, what they would like to do with Walthamstow right here in East London as the first Islamic state. They would like to create an Islamic state in that borough. Now, Zaki Badawi, who used to be he was the creator of the Islamic College here in London, he said this: a proselytizing religion cannot stand still, as Islam is known, has always been a proselytizing religion. It can either expand or contract. Islam endeavors to expand in Britain. Islam is a universal religion. It aims at bringing its message to all corners of the earth. It hopes that one day the whole of humanity will be one Muslim community, the Ummah, that's known as the believers. As we know, the history of Islam, he says, as a faith, is also the history of a state and community of believers living by divine law. The Muslims, jurists, and theologians have always expounded Islam as both government and faith. It's the one group that brings the two together. We in Christianity separate the two. Islam has always brought the secular and the sacred together, the mosque and the state together. This reflects the historical fact that Muslims from the start lived under their own law. Muslim theologians naturally produced a theology with this in view. And the reason we say that, and you know that, is because according to Islamic tradition, this Muslim state was created, the Khilafat as it's known, was created by Muhammad in 624. And from 624 up until 660, 661, you had the rightly guided caliphs. That was the first caliphate. And there have been caliphate after caliphate after caliphate from 624 up until 1924, when Kemal Atatürk finally eradicated that caliphate. That's what was always intended. It is a theology of the majority, therefore. Being a minority was never seriously considered. It was never considered at the time of the Prophet Muhammad, their prophet, not mine, nor was it ever considered in the subsequent caliphates that have then taken on since that time. Muslim theology offers, up to the present, no systematic formulation of the status of being in a minority. And that's the problem. It's never considered itself to be a minority. It's always considered itself to be in the majority, to be in charge. So let's look and see where Islam is in the world today. And you can see the graph up there. And we have other screens around here where you can see that as well. Take a look and see how big a pie that they control. Christianity right now, a little over 2 billion, 2.1 billion adherents. That's both Catholics and Protestants combined. Islam make up 1.5 billion. Now, that's even out of date. It's now up to 1.7 billion. Some would say even closer to that. It depends on which statistics you're going to look at. But you can see it's by far the second largest religion on earth. Hinduism would be the third largest religion, primarily in India. So right now, they make up about 23 to 24% of the world's population. By 2030, in another 15 or 14 years, they will be 26% of the population because they are the fastest growing religion. When you look at maps and you try to see where Islam is, these are the kind of maps you have already always see. Have you noticed this? This has always been the case. They always tend to show maps where Islam predominates primarily in North Africa and the Middle East. And the reason why, because those are percentages. Those are the percentage of Muslims in each one of those countries. So it looks like Islam is mostly in North Africa and mostly in the Middle East. Here's another map that gives that much the same idea. It's coming down the eastern coast of Africa, but primarily in the Middle East and a little bit over to the right. But it's when you look at the statistics as to where the Muslims are, statistically, where the numbers are, that suddenly you get a completely different map. And now I look at the map and you'll notice that the majority of Muslims are right here in this part of the world. Take a look at this map and you can see then where the majorities are. They're not in the Middle East, they're not in Africa, they're mostly in Asia. Mostly in Asia. And mostly in four countries, those four countries that are circled. Indonesia, Pakistan, India, and Bangladesh. Now, how many of you knew that before tonight? Very few of you. Most of you probably came here tonight thinking that Islam is primary in the Middle East, like those maps have been showing you, because those are the maps you're always getting. That's what you've always been told, that it's much more, it's an Arab religion, and it's the Arab-speaking world that primarily makes up Islam. Isn't that what you've been told? Because that's where it began, that's where its growth, and of course, that's where the most of the Muslims should be. But now we find it's actually in this part of the world. That's where the largest number of Muslims are. Here's a breakdown of what a Muslim map would look like. The Muslim world by size, that's what it would look like. You can see the four countries over here predominate. Almost half of the Muslim world is in Asia. If you take a look at the numbers, you can see Indonesia is the largest Muslim country on earth, 213 million. Pakistan is number two. 174 million. India, interestingly, is number three. How many of you knew that before tonight? One or two or three of you. Because you think of India as a Hindu nation, and yet it has the third largest Muslim population on earth. Almost all of it in the northern part of India where I grew up. That's where I was born. That's where my family is from. I've been surrounded by Muslims all my life. And that's why I think God has chosen me to work with them, because of the fact that I've had such a history of them. My family's been in India for over 100 years, since 1913. Bangladesh would be the fourth largest. Now, three of them were colonized by you. This is your colony, and at one time, before 1947, it was all one nation. When you take the populations of those three countries, Pakistan, India, and Bangladesh, you get almost 500 million Muslims. 500 million out of 1.6 or 1.7 billion. So can you see, most of you have probably never heard that before tonight. And yet, if you look at almost all of our material, all the books and the studies that we have on Islam, they're all geared towards the Arab-speaking world. Yet the Arab-speaking world only makes up 15% of all Muslims. 85% of the Muslims in the world today do not speak Arabic. Only 15% speak Arabic, and yet almost all our energies are geared towards the Arab-speaking world. We've completely lost or forgotten the Asian Muslims. We're going to talk more about that later tonight, because that has a huge impact on what we're going to do in tackling and dealing with Islam. Our tactics, our strategies, therefore, have to change. Take a look at the red area of the map up there. More people live in the red regions than in all the gray combined. The vast majority of people in the world live in Asia, not in the rest of the world. 985 million Muslims out of a total of population of 1.7 billion live in the red area, in Asia. Yet, as I said already, most of our material on Islam concerns the Middle East, which makes up only 15% of all Muslims. When we look at Europe, you can see the majority Muslim populations are in Russia, in Germany, France, United Kingdom, less so in Italy, and somewhat in Sweden. Now that's going to change because this is already out of date since the migration that's happened just this last year. In the last year now, Germany is taking on a major role as far as Islam. 1 million have come to Germany in just 1 year. There could be as that many and double next year because of the ones waiting to come from Turkey. Anywhere from 2 to 3 million will probably come next year if the migration continues. Sweden is another place that's now bursting at the seams with the number of Muslims that are moving in, and we haven't even begun to understand how that's going to have an impact socially, politically, economically, and theologically. So that's why we're talking about it tonight, and that's why we're bringing it together. We need to start waking up to the growth of Islam that's happening, not just around the world, but certainly here in Europe. When you look at Africa, almost all of the Muslim countries are in the northern part, that green area, a bit coming down the eastern coast. And that line, what we call the Muslim line, which differentiates the Muslim half of Africa with the Christian half, that line is moving down about 3 kilometers every year. It's pushing its way down, roughly around 3 kilometers every year. So next year it'll be a different line, and the year after it'll be a different line as Islam is encroaching and moving quickly through Africa. The Muslim population in the world today, as I said, 1.7 billion, 1.6, depending on which figures you're gonna look at. By 2030, it'll be over 2 billion, and by 2070, it will have surpassed Christianity as the largest religion on earth. That's what the current figures are. That depends on whether or not the Muslim world continues to grow. And the reason why I say that is the growth in Islam is not conversion growth. Almost all the growth in Islam is by biological growth. They have bigger families. In this country, the average family has 1.6 children. Don't ask me how, but they do. The Muslim mother has 4.8. Sorry, let me do that again. 4.2 children per family. So 1.6 versus 4.2, you can see why they're growing so fast. They just have more children. And the difference is once you're a Muslim, you are born into Islam. You don't choose it, it chooses you. To leave it, of course, are dire consequences. And you know the consequences. All four schools of law, the Hanafi, the Hanbali, the Maliki, the Shafi school, all dictate that if you leave Islam, you do so on pain of death. It's a capital punishment, usually either done by the father or the oldest brother. So you have already the problem of growing Islam, a growing Islamic movement around the world, and will surpass Christianity, both Protestants and Catholics put together by, according to the latest statistics, 2070. Now, when we look at Europe, Western Europe has about 13 million Muslims. That's going to change. I'm going to have to keep updating this because of the migration of the enormous number of Muslims that are coming in as we speak. France, about 4.16 million. Germany, 3.2. That would now be over 4 million now since the migration. United Kingdom, 1.8 million, up to anywhere from 2.5 to 3, depending on what sources you're going to use. Soon there will be more Muslims than there will be Anglicans in this country. The demographic breakdown here, you can see where they are, and we make Germany a little bit greener because it's becoming more of an Islamic state. A larger Islamic population. And when you look at the populations in selected countries, you can see that France is going to be the largest. It's already the largest as of 2010. By 2030, it'll have over 10 million. Then will come Sweden with around 10 million, and then will come Netherlands. Germany will have to change, and these graphs we're going to have to change year by year. because, of course, because of the migration, it will jump ahead of many of the other nations. Britain is right now around the third largest. It will possibly be the fourth. And maybe if Sweden keeps going the way it does, we may even be the fifth. When you look at Britain itself, and I'm not going to spend too much time on Britain because Alan's going to talk about Britain next week. But when you look at Britain, the majority of Muslims are right here in London. There are six cities in Britain that have a population of Muslims that's 10% or more of the population. Bradford with 16%, Luton with 14%, Birmingham with 14%, London with 11.7%, Oldham with 11.1%, and Leicester with 11%. But when you look at the 11.7% for London, with a population of anywhere from 10 to 14 million, that's a million Muslims right there. Of the 1.7 to 2 million that are in all of Britain, that means half of all Muslims live in London, which is going to have an impact on you. And that's why it's important that we do this here in London. And that's why I thank you for doing it and letting us allow you to do it here in Kensington Temple, because you have such a huge, enormous amount of influence here in London. And that's why it's good that we're actually unpacking it and going to have an entire day that's going to be dedicated to Islam in Britain next week. It's not, therefore, a surprise that last year, the most popular name amongst young boys is Muhammad, or was Muhammad, because of the growth that's going on here. The British government and Islam in the UK, let's take a look at this, use Britain as a context as to what's happening in the governmental circles and what's happening with Islam here in this country. Now, I don't want to spend too much time here because we don't want to take away from what Alan's going to do next week. Muslims have been coming here for the last, well, since the 18th century, and they came primarily as traders back in the 18th century. Then during the Victorian period, when the Islam was dominated, was colonialized, a third of the Muslim world was colonized by Britain. And for that reason, there's an awful lot of Muslims that came here because of that colonial experience. After the Second World War, then, there is another migration of Muslims that came this direction, primarily to be conductors on the trains and the buses. They needed an awful lot of men to do that, and most of them came from the colonial areas, which included Pakistan, India, and Bangladesh. In 1947, then, they split up into three countries. Then there was family reunification for the men that had come before. Many of them were poor. They tended to come from the Kashmiri area of Milpur, and they were Milpuri people. Many of them were rural, and so they did not have the educational background that many of the other immigrants had. That changed, however, in the 1970s when a large influx of Muslims came from Eastern Africa, primarily from Uganda, with Idi Amin and his edict throwing out many of the Muslims there. And what was interesting, they did come with education. A good number of them also came with a lot of finances. So they were in a different social class than the Milpuris who were already here. And that, of course, that changed the whole focus for an awful lot of Muslims that were here. And then most recently, we've had a large influx of Arab Muslims that have come in, primarily and we'll hear more about this next week, for buying up land, businesses. We're going to hear an awful lot about that next week with Arab oil money. When you look at who the Muslims are in this country, of the roughly 1.6 to 2.7 million, making about 4.8% of the population, they're mostly concentrated in cities, where you would think they would be, because that's where they feel invited, that's where they feel there are others of their kind, and that's why they tend to join those who are already here. The vast majority of them are from the Indian subcontinent because of the colonial experience and the Commonwealth. They come from the Commonwealth. Most of them from South Asia, those three countries. About 270,000 from Africa. 210 are whites. These are not converts. These are mostly those from Albania and from the other Balkan countries that have come here. And then the mixed race, 102,000. When you look at the Sunni-Shiite divide, 85% of them are Sunni. Shiites would be about 13%, which reflects what you see around the world. That's about the same statistics of Sunni and Shiite Islam internationally. And then a much smaller proportion of Ahmadiyya. Do you all know what Ahmadiyyas are? They're not really Muslims. They are a sect within Islam, not considered by Muslims to be legitimate, because they have another prophet who comes later named Ghulam Ahmad, who comes in the 1800s, supposedly as the Messiah, as a reincarnation of Jesus. And he was born in Kashmir, and he did his revelations in Kashmir. And that's why he believed that he was the reincarnation. Came with the idea that Jesus, when he was on the cross, did not die, that he swooned, was put into the grave. He woke up 3 days later, threw off the 2-ton stone, overpowered the guards, and then went to Kashmir and died in Kashmir, from where he came back in 1800 in the person of Ghulam Ahmad. And that's why the Ahmadiyyas are seen more like a sect within Islam. They would be comparable to the Mormons or the Jehovah Witnesses for us, in that, like the Mormons, who have a different prophet named Joseph Smith, which is my name, came with another book. I still haven't found mine, with special glasses. Nonetheless, he was a prophet that came after, and much like Ghulam Ahmad, was another prophet that came after Muhammad with another revelation. Interestingly, because of the fact that they come from that part of the world, they've been highly persecuted, and most of their leaders have now moved to London, and in Tooting is where they have their largest mosque. And so you see quite a few Ahmadiyyas here in London. Some of you probably have had contact with them. Now, looking at the ethnic breakdown, as I said earlier, the Indian subcontinent makes up the majority of them, 70%, and you break that down, almost half of them come from Pakistan, from Mirpur and Kashmir. The Bangladeshis, the Siletis, they have the best food, they have the best cooks. If you have a good Indian restaurant, always ask who the cook is. If they're from Silet, you're going to get the best food in the world. That's the best Indian food, better than even Indian, I can say that, as an Indian, having grown up there. And they make up 16% of the population here. The Indians tend to come from Gujarat, that little tail that sticks out into the Arabian Sea, and that's where 8% come from, and the Arabs would be about 11%, and the rest from the Middle East and Africa. So that's the ethnic breakdown of the Muslims in Britain. They tend to be the underclass. A third of the Muslims are under the age of 16. The average age is 28 years. They're very young, versus 41 national average. 42% of the Muslims live in overcrowded conditions, 12% live without any central heating, 62% are unemployed. They are lower than any other faith group in Britain, mostly in low-paid sectors of the economy. Though they only make up 2% of the population here, they are 9% of all prisoners, so they tend to have an awful problem with the law. And of course, they tend to also have very poor health. If you look at the total, there on the left, you will see that the Muslims are much poorer, male and female, than the national average, which is the orange part over here versus the brown. Other faces of Islam, they are those in the next generation who are educated, and there are those who are ambitious, and we are finding a whole new class of Muslims that are coming up that are quite well-educated, and Alan's going to talk about that next week. They're making a much more of a big presence in the UK. Many foreign Muslims that are very well off are now moving to the UK, mainly to Britain. And many of them are coming from very stable environments, especially the children, and they're investing now in Britain. So that's another side of Islam that we don't usually hear about. We'll see more about that next week. Now, they are growing in their influence. They have now created Islamic courts here. I don't know if you know that, but since 2009, Islamic law is now considered to be appropriate, is legitimate in this country. And there are about 80 Islamic courts now here in Britain. Sharia finances. This has just been in the news in the last week. Richmond House, that's just down the road in Whitehall, where many of the MPs are going to have to move to when they refurbish Westminster. They're going to have to move to Richmond House, but they're not going to be able to drink. No alcohol is allowed in Richmond House because it's using Islamic finances. And because it's using Islamic finances, they have to imbue sukuk laws, which prohibits any drinking of alcohol. And I'm not sure if they're allowed to have pork or to pray there. We're going to find that out, aren't we, Alan? Because we want to know if we are able to pray in Richmond House or if we can have our pork sandwiches. That'd be interesting to see if that's also illegitimate. So there's an awful lot of ramifications what's happening with Sharia financing. Property. We're going to talk more about that next week. The energy supplies, enormous amount of control over our energy supplies. Aviation, one of the largest, in fact, the largest, growing to be the largest carrier on earth. Emirates Airlines is now Islamic owned. And of course, the halal. When you look at the halal markets, the fact that they are now proliferating in almost every area of our schools and hospitals, restaurants. 70% of New Zealand lamb now, which is shipped all over the world, is now halal lamb, and 31% of their chicken is halal. And these are the different organizations now that are serving halal meats. Many of them are household names. Most of them you probably go to and use. And most, some of you have found, in case my case, where I live in my part of London, you can only eat halal meat at the subways that are there. I can't find ham anymore in any of those subways in my area of the city. And I complain every time I go, and I make sure I pray over it. You can do the same thing. Just pray over it and bring it back to God. And do so audibly so everybody hears you. Because I think it's important that we show that we are upset that we have to eat this meat that's dedicated to another god. Bring it home. Bring it home. Now, mosques, Islamic structures. Here in the UK, there's about 1,800. They're building another 240. Many of them are, you've probably, many of them you have seen. A lot of the times here in London, they're taking over churches. I went to a church not too far from where I live, and off of Edgware Road, and I remember looking and walking in there, and they wanted me to go into the sanctuary, and they'd taken out all the pews, taken out and destroyed this beautiful congregational church, taken out all the windows, stained glass, beautiful stained glass windows, and replaced it with plexiglass. And they had redirected the church in this direction, though the front was here. And the imam wanted to show me, they had put carpets down. See, now the Qibla is here. We have finally redirected the church the way it should have been intended. It was like a slap in the face to me, but he did that for my own benefit. And that's what they're doing to a lot of our churches here. They're moving in, taking over the churches, throwing out that which is beautiful and replacing it with that which is simple and redirect it towards Mecca. The Olympic Mosque was going to be the largest mosque in Europe, 70,000 seaters. And I just want to point to this man over here. This man stopped it single-handedly. We need to give him a hand for doing that. Tablighi Jamaat, one of the largest and fastest growing radical groups in the world that wanted to build that mosque. It has a membership of 80 million. That's larger than the entire population of Britain. And yet he single-handedly stood against them. They're in 120 countries. And May was able to shut that mosque down from being built there where he comes from in Newham. So we need one man. Look what one man can do. And that's why we work with Alan. And that's why we appreciate the effort that he has given. God bless him and continue to bless him as he works. Quranic schools, 5,000 Quranic schools, and growing exponentially. Now, some of them are legitimate. Some of them are actually recognized by the government. Many of them are illegal. Nonetheless, they do exist, and the ones that are legal are the ones that are probably in the news, the one we saw with the Trojan horse scandal there in Birmingham. There's an emphasis on Islamic teaching, a focus on studying the world from Muslim context. They must, if they are getting any money from the government, must allow non-Muslims to come, but they see that as a missionary endeavor where they can then proselytize for potential converts. Political structures, and we're not going to get into that. There's a whole slew of ones that I could get into, but we don't have the time, and I think I'm going to let Alan work with these next week. But I do want to talk about the Dawah organization, because these are the organizations that are now proliferating. These are the evangelistic missional organizations that are now doing a very effective job here in Britain. And these are the ones that you're going to come in contact with as you evangelize Muslims. Probably the biggest and probably the most prolific one is the one that's on the screen right there. IERA, Islamic Education and Research Academy, that is headquartered on North Circular Road. And it's this group that we have to contend with, I have to work with, against, and have for the last number of years. During the Olympics, they were the ones that had, in fact, that shirt that you see there, "Life is just a game." Have any of you seen those shirts? They used to have them around the Olympic venues in 2012. And they trained up 600 young men to go up to the tourists, to talk to them, to engage with them concerning not only what they believe, but also what the problems were with Christianity. And it's fascinating to see their enthusiasm, many of them using the very same tactics that we use. They were using many of our Christian missional tactics. These are some of the bright young men that are leading it. There you can see Hamza Tortis there. Others I'll talk about later in this talk. And of course, the man that leads it, Abdul Rahim Green. He and I have known each other for many years. Back in the 1990s, he used to come to Speaker's Corner regularly and would be there on the ladder, and we would engage with each other face to face or side by side or back to back. And it was fascinating because he cut his teeth at Speaker's Corner, and that's where I cut my teeth. So we go back quite a few years. He's now has two wives and is a spokesman for the Regent's Park Mosque here in London, but he's also heading up the IARA group. Now, this group gets £800,000 a year from the Saudi Arabian government to push their material all over the world. Adnan Rashid is another one that was one of their primary spokesmen. We'll talk more about him later on, so I won't spend too much on him right now. He's a good friend, and we've had an awful lot of good time together. Debating has been one of their primary focuses. We'll talk more about their debaters, and we'll look and unpack them later on in this talk. The organization that's done the most debating by for the Muslims in Dawah work is the MDI, Muslim Debate Initiative. Abdullah Al-Andalusi, Paul Williams, Sam Zatari are three of their foremost debaters. Now, when you go to their meetings, and I encourage you to do that, if you have a chance, whenever you see anything that is advertised by IARA or MDI or any of these other FOSIS or Islamic societies, ISOCs that are in on university campuses, if you have a chance, go and see what they're saying. And here's what you're going to find. You'll find the same narrative in almost all their meetings. You'll hear this that comes up all the time, that the West is in decline. What they're saying is, look at the West and see what's happening morally. Look and see what's happening socially. Look and see what's happening as far as the one-parent families, the difficulty with the drugs, the enormous amount of pornography that's on the internet, things like this. And they do have a very good agenda. There are some of the things that we would agree with. Culturally, there seems to be a loss of identity. Spiritually, the fact that only 5 to 7% of the populace even goes to church here in Britain is something they pick up on. And they're saying that actually more Muslims go to the mosque than Christians go to church anymore. And of course, they have a problem with capitalism because it uses usury, and with democracy because it allows every man one vote, and it stands against God's law, which they consider to be eternal. Because the West is in decline in almost every area, they say, Christianity is to blame. And the reason why is because we have a corrupted scripture. And it's basically a scripture that's lost its sell-by date. It's no longer relevant. You can see the statistics of the people who are going to church, 5 to 7%. Therefore, since there is a corrupted scripture creating this decline that's happening socially, morally, economically, and politically, the answer then, of course, is Islam. You can see it's a very simple solution. Why? Because Islam is a 24/7 religion. It teaches you how to walk, talk, eat, drink, sleep. Everything you do is dictated by the traditions that are there. And that's why it's the only religion that is a 24/7 religion. Christianity is a religion that only meets on Sundays, except Friday nights here, and of course, rest of the week. This is a unique church, though, but most churches only meet on Sunday, maybe 2 hours on a Sunday morning, and that's it. And that's what they see as Christianity. That's all they see, is the viability of Christianity. So they're, you can see why this resonates with an awful lot of young Muslims, and certainly it does on university campuses. Their specific agenda was put together by Ali Qahtani, and he said that Muslims must band together. They must not be assimilated by the majority culture. They must establish areas of high Muslim concentration. They must set up mosques, community centers, and Islamic schools. They must share the message of Islam with the unbelievers. That's called dahwa, to invite their evangelistic endeavor. It's a responsibility of every Muslim living in a non-Muslim land, and that the objective for Muslims should be the majority or the entire nation should be governed according to Islam. Now, this has been out, look at the date. This has been out since 1980. This is not new. This has been out for 35 years. So all of us should be aware of their agenda. He goes on to say that a Muslim community must become a majority community. It must continue to request the same rights as the other religious communities enjoy, gain political rights as a constituent community of the nation, and then once these rights are obtained, then the community should seek to generalize its characteristics to the entire nation. So basically, they want to take over, and they have been very, very transparent about it. This is not a hidden document. This is well known. We've known about it since the 1980s. Ghulam Murad, who is well known here in the 1980s in the Islamic movement in the West, said that an Islamic movement is an organized struggle to change the existing society into an Islamic society based on the Quran and the Sunnah and make Islam, which is a code for entire life, supreme and dominant, especially in the socio-political spheres. And he was living in Leicester when he said that. How do they want to operate? There are five main areas, and this is what you're finding on the university campuses. Now, I used to work on the university campuses in the 1990s. First and foremost, they want to introduce talks and debates, and we used to have a lot of these back in the 1990s. They've been now shut down more recently because of this fear of conflict between Christianity and Islam. And they used to focus on the social unemployment, economic problems, the hijab, problems of the hijab. They would focus on moral difficulties within Western corruption, the problems with the family, the one-parent family, the indiscipline that's happening within the families, the difficulty with women and their promiscuity amongst women and the way they dress and the way they act. They talked about the political problems, primarily focusing on what's happening in Syria, Iraq, Afghanistan, and especially Israel. Israel always came out in many of their talks. And of course, the theological problems. And when you go to their meetings, almost in every case, they're always on the offense. Attacking our scriptures, attacking the person of Jesus Christ, and using science as a means to show that Islam has all the answers. They have also proselytizing meetings. This is for everybody. Everybody can go. But whenever you go to these meetings on campus, I've always noticed, though they advertise them as coming to hear about Islam and know about Islam, they spend their entire times attacking Christianity. Rarely do you ever leave finding anything more about Islam. All you find is all the problems with Christianity. Have you noticed that? And that's the same almost everywhere I go. Come to Speaker's Corner on any given Sunday and find any Muslim with a Quran in their hand or that wants to talk and tell you how great Islam is, but they will tell you everything wrong with Christianity and how the Trinity makes no sense and how the Lord Jesus Christ never claimed to be God. And of course, that's before they even get on to our scriptures. They have Islamic awareness weeks modeled after our Christian unions, where they have book stalls and proselytizing meetings. And of course, the literature, in almost every case, if you look at the literature, it's all polemical. Polemical means it's on the attack. It's always attacking. Rarely is it defending. Rarely do they really talk about what Islam can bring economically, what Islam can bring socially, what Islam can bring spiritually. They're always confronting that which is in front. They have training days for Muslim students, and you can't go to these, obviously. These are for only Muslims. But what's fascinating from what we've heard is they do much the same type of training schools that we have. And they put out book tables, videos, tapes, training conferences, very much modeled after our training days that we have in Christianity and have had for the last 100 years. Much of their agenda tends to revolve around these themes, the cultural mandate that Islam is the final religion, it will have the final model, it is the universal religion with the universal model, and that Islam will dominate culturally. Scientific exegesis, looking and seeing where all the supposed scientific problems in the Bible, but that Islam has enormous number of scientific proofs. If you open up and you look at Al Jazeera television, which is the most prolific television for Muslim world, take a look at any one of their evening talks by Sheikh Yusuf Qaradawi has a whole litany of these scientific proofs in the Quran. Looking at the embryological cycle, the hydrological cycle, it just goes on and on. It's an entire industry of showing how great the Quran is because of these scientific proofs. Hopeless, actually. The arguments are actually hopeless, but nonetheless, they're there. The pagan sources for the Bible, and this is Abdul Rahman Green's favorite material. And then, of course, the polemics, attacking the Trinity, attacking our Lord Jesus Christ, attacking our scriptures. The major players are Dr. Shabir Ali, Dr. Zakir Naik, Mansur Ahmad, Adnan Rashid. These are the major players that we're finding around the world and, of course, here in Britain. Now, student societies have now shut down the debates that used to be prolific in the 1990s. I was always invited to go on and do debates after debate after debate on university campuses in the 1990s. No longer am I invited. Well, there are two reasons. One is our material is so much better now. They don't like to invite us because we destroy almost all their material. You're going to see that in the coming weeks. But the other reason is there's this fear that maybe Christians and Muslims will attack each other. That's never happened at a debate. Nonetheless, the fear is there. And so they debilitate free speech. And they believe also that in these debates that the Islamists will dominate the radical Muslims. And there is a fear in this country of radical Islam. So let's talk about radical Islam. We need to bring it in because you can't talk about Islam in Europe without talking about radical Islam. And specifically about ISIS. Now, I'm going to spend an entire talk just on ISIS. So that's not my remit tonight, okay? We're not going to talk about ISIS tonight, but we need to bring it in. We need to show that there is a real problem in Europe dealing with radical Islam. I've put right at the center of my picture this man right here. How many of you know who that man is? That's Abu Rumaysa. He used to be known as Siddhartha Dar. Our team knows him really well. One of the men in our team used to engage with him every Saturday there in Stratford in front of the station. And then a few months ago, he just jokingly said to him, listen, you used to be a Hindu. He was a Hindu. Siddhartha Dar is his Hindu name. He became a Muslim and then took on Rumaysa. Abu Rumaysa was his Muslim name. And as he was engaging with my friend, he said, you should go and join ISIS. You sound so much like them. And lo and behold, the next week he did. And this is the picture that he then sent back there in Raqqa in Syria with his newborn child holding an AK-47 in one hand and the newborn child in his other hand. Now, this man has now become the new Jihadi John. You know, the old Jihadi John was killed by American drones, the man that cut off the heads of all those journalists and aid workers. This is the new Jihadi John. And just a few weeks ago, he executed 5 people on film, reading the Quran as he executed them, using a gun. He's from London. He's from Walthamstow. He's from your city. He's from here. Converted by Muhajirun Party, converted by one of the most radical groups. We're going to talk more about them in about 2 weeks. ISIS punishments, you've seen them. The one on the left, they're in almost every case, whenever they do these punishments, they take it right out of Scripture. What they're doing there on the left in Aleppo by crucifying him and cutting his hands and feet off from opposite end, that's from Surah 5, Ayah 33. Cutting off his hands, that's Surah 5, Ayah 38. So this comes straight out of the Quran. And the spread of ISIS that's now moved right across northern Africa, as far over as Afghanistan, and of course, as it's in the impact that's happening in Syria and Iraq, and the enormous amount of attraction of ISIS. We're going to talk more about that in 2 weeks, so I don't want to say too much, but you can see just from the graph how this attraction has pulled in young men, Muslim men and women from all over the Western world and also from North Africa. This is their map that they have put out. This is what they want the world to look like in 5 years. Khorasan, Hijaz, Yaman, the land of Habasha, Maghrib, Andalus. These are the archaic names, the Islamic names for these countries. So they do have an agenda we need to be aware of and we need to talk about. Now, people have always asked me, well, how do we know that this ISIS or these Boko Haram or Al-Shabaab or Al-Qaeda or any of these Jamaat-e-Islami or Islamic Tablighi Jamaat, how do we know that they represent the majority of Muslims? That question was asked in 2004 when Pew International went around the world and asked the question in they just chose 4 countries, Turkey, Morocco, Jordan, and Pakistan, to ask back in 2004, so we're talking over 10 years ago, whether or not radical Islam was really a problem and whether or not Muslims supported it. In Turkey, 31% said yes, they supported it. In Morocco, it was 45%. In Jordan, it was 55%. And most troubling, in Pakistan, it was 65%. That would be roughly about 80 million out of a population of 140 back then in 2004. So we're not talking about small groups. We're talking about, in some cases, half the Muslim population now has moved to the right, is supporting that agenda. We'll talk more about this in 2 weeks. So we've got to talk about it. We can't walk away from it anymore. This radicalization is happening here in Britain as well. It's happening in our schools with jihadi fighters who are now leaving to join in Syria and Iraq and the Islamic societies who have been radicalized. About 30% of the Islamic societies in our universities have now become radicalized. It's coming out in our Islamic banking, no-go areas, and in the whole mission. So you have these kind of infidelophobia, but that's a hard word to pronounce. Help me here, infidelophobia. Phobia against the infidels. Behead those who insult Islam. That's right from our London streets. Islam will dominate in front of the White House. So how has the West responded to this radicalization, this growing radicalization in our own midst? Since 9/11, here in London, it's been 7-7, July the 7th. Radical Islam has imposed itself as never before with groups like ISIS, Al-Qaeda, Boko Haram, Al-Shabaab. There is a confusion. We don't know how to respond. Muslims don't know how to respond. Our government doesn't know how to respond. And certainly the church doesn't know how to respond. We've been caught flat-footed. Well, some Europeans are just getting fed up and they use imagery to communicate their fears. Secular comics react against Sharia, with now Sharia-free zones. And then, of course, the humor is employed to deal with difficult topics. I especially like the one over here on the right. But there is a confusion within Islam itself. Muslims don't know what to do. And here you have on one side love for all, and on the other side Ayn Hirsi Ali, probably one of the most courageous women I know, who from a Somalian background has now left Islam and has bothered to actually confront it head on, and does so vocally, but has been litigated against and has been vilified, and of course is living under a death threat because of what she said, spoken up from inside. Is it ISIS terror or is it peaceful prayer that defines Islam? And that's the problem that most Muslims are now asking. They don't know. Some have been dishonest, like Abbas Hizan, who is the father of that Methnal Green girl, one of the three girls that left and joined ISIS. And then he had this famous time when he came on television there in 2015, suggesting that the reason she had become radicalized is because of the police and because of MI5. And then the next week, these images came out of him right there in 2012 burning an American flag. Turned out that he was as radical as anybody, and turned out that maybe the radicalism of his daughter may have to do with him. It was in his own family. And of course, that exposed him. Or maybe it's the Quran that's confused. And we're going to talk about this. What do you do with Surah 5, Ayah 32 versus Surah 8, Ayah 12? And these are things we're going to have to unpack, and we're going to look at it more in the coming weeks. Politicians are confused. You have Obama over on this side saying that Islam has demonstrated through words and deeds the possibilities of religious tolerance and racial equality. And then you have these politicians like Gladstone, Quincy Adams, Winston Churchill, who say just the opposite. So what are we going to do with this confusion that's going on? The law tends to look the other way, and this is why we need to come to some type of solution. Now, there are Christians and secularists who are jumping into action to stop and to confront it and to deal with it. One of them is Baroness Cox, a very good friend of Alan's and mine. In fact, Alan, you work with her quite a bit, enormously, and she has been just a towering, courageous woman to not only work with but to see. She has been at the forefront of engaging publicly with Islam around the world, especially with what's happening in Africa, and of course with the whole difficulty of slavery that's happening, and has actually exposed the slavery that exists there, still exists only in Muslim countries. More recently, she's been involved with the arbitration and mediation services, the Equalities Bill, confronting the Islamic courts that are here in Britain, because of what they're doing to women, well, what they do to families, what they do to societies and cultures, communities. And so that's why she's been at the forefront to stop these courts. And you need to pray for her because she's doing a great job with that. Dr. Jenny Taylor is a friend of mine, and she is the one that has put together a group called the Lapidomedia, which engages in trying to get journalists and the media up to scratch, to know what's happening, to be engaged with Muslims here in Britain especially. And of course, she is one that, along with Alan, who has helped to expose the Tablighi Jamaat and came out with the Tablighi Jamaat book on exposing that one group. And of course, my hero, Alan Craig. I don't know if you can get one better than that, to have somebody like that to be able to stand up against this mosque. That was what the picture of what the mosque was going to look like. They would have seated 70,000 people, bigger than any other structure. Certainly even bigger than St. Paul's, wouldn't it? And much bigger than St. Peter's in Rome. So you can see why it was important that we did stop this mosque. We don't stop mosque building, but large ones like that. Alan and I have a good friend, Lord Pearson, who is working in the House of Lords, coming up with question after question after question, just bombarding the Muslims with questions. God bless him for doing that. And has been a real thorn in their sides for the last few years. He's been confronting the law of abrogation. He has also been confronting the increasing UK Islamization. And so it's been great to be able to help him, support him, and to work with him there in the House of Lords. Douglas Murray is not a Christian. He is from the Henry Jackson Society. He's an avowed atheist, but he is one of the few atheists that's actually taking a stand against Islam and has been one of the most eloquent in debates and also on television, Question Time, BBC's Question Time, to be able to confront it at its foundation. Came out with his book, Islamophilia, The Love of Islam, that he came out with. But really, the only ones that can really confront Islam have to be us. we're going to say more about this in 2 weeks. Really, it has to be radical Christians to take on radical Islam. The reason why is number of reasons. One is that we're the only ones that really understand them. And this has really become apparent in the last few years. We're the only ones that understand what motivates them. We're the only ones that actually start from the same paradigm. We start from Scripture as they start from Scripture. We go to a model named Jesus as they go to a model named Muhammad. And what a better model Jesus is. There's no one that can stand up to Jesus. And that's why he is the answer for every person, every time, every place, and every day. And that's why we need to introduce Jesus into this whole debate and in his model and his example. We'll talk more about that in 2 weeks as we unpack it. But we need confident Christians, and that's what we don't have. We don't have people like the Baroness Coxes or the Alan Craigs, the people like that in the church. We haven't found enough people to stand up to Islam. We haven't had enough people to go public with what they believe. And when Christianity is confident, then Islam cannot stand against it. But when Christianity gets weak, then Islam will move forward. And that's why we need to be careful that we don't let it pass us by. So who are the main players? Because there is a conflict going on, and there are some major players that are actually taking on this theological debate. And the theological debate is really where the debate is happening. Now, remember I said, and I looked at those maps at the very beginning, and you noticed that the majority of Muslims were in Asia. Remember that? About 900 million are in Asia. And I said that four of the countries are the foremost countries, Indonesia, Pakistan, India, and Bangladesh. Three of those countries were colonized by Britain, Pakistan, India, and Bangladesh, and that their total populations made up 480 million, basically half a billion Muslims just in the Indian subcontinent. And I said also that we were not paying attention to that Indian subcontinent, that most of our energies were geared towards the Arab world, which only made up 15%. The reason I bring that up now is because if in order to confront Islam, you're going to have to confront it ideologically. And in order to confront it ideologically, you're going to have to confront that which the ideology comes from. You can't confront ideology using bombs, bullets, and cruise missiles as much as my president thinks you can, or even David Cameron thinks you can. You cannot use bombs, bullets, and cruise missiles to destroy the ideology which drives Muslims, not just radical Muslims, but all Muslims. And in order to take on that ideology, you're going to have to take on those people who are at the forefront of that ideology. And the people who are at the forefront of ideology, I'm going to show you now. The ones who are actually taking the ideology of Islam are not Arab-speaking. In almost every case, they speak English. But they're not English. They tend to come from the Indian subcontinent. We did a survey in 2006 to find out where the main players were, to find out who is really confronting Christianity and who is confronting the ideology that we stand for. Because in order to fight their ideology, you're going to have a better ideology, and we've got it. Christianity is the only ideology that can take on Islam. Don't want to get into that too much tonight. We'll do that in 2 weeks. But the main players are not from the Arab-speaking world. In fact, I can't even think of one real Arab speaker who is confronting the Bible or who's confronting the Trinity of Jesus Christ and our Lord and our Spirit, or confronting the Christology of Jesus, or is confronting our scriptures. Can you think of one Arab speaker? Do you know of any? If you come down to Speaker's Corner and if you engage with the people who are there on any given Sunday, you will notice there are Arabs there. There are people from North Africa. There are people from Turkey. There are people from Asia. And when you talk to the Arabs, and you try to get into a theological conversation, they just want to talk about politics. They want to talk about the problems with Israel. They want to talk about what's happening in Syria. They just want to talk about what's happening geopolitically. They don't want to engage theologically because they don't even know that we exist. We don't appear on their radar. When you talk to a Turk, you're going to have to tell them what they're to believe before you can even engage with them, because they don't even know dilly swat about Islam. They just know they're Muslims. You talk to someone from North Africa and they want to talk about the colonial experience, about the French problem in Algeria and Morocco. Not theological. They don't engage theologically. When you talk to an Asian, however, from India or Pakistan or Bangladesh, many times they will have Bibles in their hands. And in the Bibles were little post-it notes all the way through with different seeming contradictions and seeming historical anachronism and seeming scientific errors of the Bible. God bless them for bringing Bibles with them. Because then I know that I'm going to have a real confrontation, and I know I'm going to have a theological debate with them. And I know almost from the point go that they're going to talk about Jesus Christ. And they're going to confront Jesus Christ. And usually if they don't, I usually introduce them and I say, I believe that Jesus is God. I believe the Bible is the Word of God. Do you have an opinion? And they will have 2 hours of opinion about those two subjects. That's why, as Colin said, they're the easiest people to talk to. They're so easy to engage with because they love to talk about Issa. Issa. And I have a problem with Issa. He's not my Jesus. If you were to come down to have to come down this last Sunday to Speaker's Corner, we unpacked Issa at Speaker's Corner. We confronted who that Issa was. Even the word doesn't make much sense to me. Issa is not even an Arabic name. It doesn't appear in any Arabic journal prior to the Quran. In fact, it was introduced by the Quran in the 7th century. Ooh, I lie. In the 8th century. There is no Issa at all in the Arab-speaking world. The name for Jesus in the Arab-speaking world has always been Yeshua. So how did they get it wrong? Well, they've got the wrong Jesus. Simple as that. Now, why aren't we telling Muslims this? Why aren't we showing them what a hopeless Issa they've got? He spends his whole time as a child making little birds out of clay, and then spends his entire time as an adult basically denying his divinity. That's not my Jesus. Refuses to get up on the cross and lets another man die in his place. My Jesus? Please. And that's why we've got to confront the Quran. We're the only ones that are doing can do though. But what's fascinating to me, we went up on YouTube in 2006, and we wanted to find out how many of these YouTubes were attacking Christianity, and we came up with 43,000 videos against Christianity back in 2006. That's 10 years ago. 43,000 that were attacking our Lord and Savior, that are attacking our scriptures, that are attacking the whole history of Christianity. They were attacking almost everything that I consider to be valuable. And then we wanted to find out how many videos were up there that were actually confronting Islam. We only came up with 17. 17 versus 43,000. Who do you think was ahead? And that's why the group that had done the survey came to me and asked if I would start putting videos up. And if you go up on Fander Films, P-F-A-N-D-E-R Films, you can see our videos, over 100 that we have up there now since 2006. We just put up another one today on who is Issa. We took about 2 hours to unpack who Issa was, Hatun and I on the ladder there at Speaker's Corner. And folks, we've got to realize that there is a debate, a theological debate, that is much more important than the geopolitical debate, that which is happening in Syria, that's what is happening in radical Islam. Radical Islams are there, but they have to do what they're doing because of a book modeled by a man. And in order to confront that kind of Islam, we're going to have to confront that book. And we're going to have to confront that man. And that's what we're going to do in 3 weeks and in 4 weeks. We're going to confront those two and wait till you see what we have. You're going to smile when you realize how hopeless that man is and how hopeless that book is. And I say that from Speaker's Corner. I say that from the rooftops. I don't mind at all Muslims hearing me say that. Because that's exactly what we're finding out about the Quran. And that's exactly what we're finding out about Muhammad. So let's look and see who are the ones that are at the forefront. Let's look at the Muslim debaters. Look at the ones, these are the ones who are, that we have found to be the best and the brightest, the ones who are confronting us. And to start with, you have to start with Ahmadinejad. Ahmadinejad, if any of you have ever seen him, go up on YouTube, just look at some of his debates. He has been, back in the 1970s and 1980s, up until the 1990s, he was the most prolific, the most popular debater, bar none, anywhere in the world. But he is not from the Arab-speaking world. He is from India. Though he lived in Durban in South Africa, and he did most of his work in Durban, but he had a very strong Indian accent from Gujarati roots. Almost all of his material was against Christianity. Lampoons our Bible, lampoons our Lord, lampoons Jesus, and spends all of his time in polemics. And that's why he was so popular, because of his popular polemical background. The man who I debated my first debate in 1995 here at Cambridge University was this man, Dr. Jamal Badawi. The first time I'd ever done any debate, any formal debate, not informal debates like we have at Speaker's Corner. That was 1995. That was over 20 years ago on the Quran, the problems of the historical problems of the Quran. Dr. Jamal Badawi was the most prolific writer back then. He had a series on the Quran, about 350 different videos on the Quran, and that's why they was chosen to debate me on the historical problem. He had no answer to the 10 challenges we gave. That's in 1995. We still have that video. We still have the material from that debate. We put it up on the debate website in 1995 of August. He has yet to answer any of those 10 challenges. He can't. And you'll see why in 3 weeks. But probably the best debater in the Muslim world today is Dr. Shabir Ali. Dr. Shabir Ali is from Toronto, but he is from India. His background is Indian. Dr. Shabir Ali is the best one because he is probably the best equipped. But he is so intellectual that much of his material against the Bible, because he always confronts the Bible and the person of Jesus Christ. He talks about the evolution of this Christology of Jesus between Mark and John. That's his signature piece. Much of it goes right over the heads of most Muslims. They don't understand what he's talking about. But Christians do. We understand what he's talking about. And that's why we have to engage him. But he cannot defend the Quran. And he cannot defend Muhammad. And that's his Achilles heel. And that became apparent a year and a half ago when I debated him in Toronto. I've debated him 6 times. And the biggest one was just a year and a half ago in 2014 when I debated him on the Quran, introducing some of the material I'm going to introduce in 3 weeks. Sorry, 4 weeks. Looking at the manuscript evidence for the Quran, he had no response except the number 19. The number 19. You'll question, what am I talking about? Come in 3 or 4 weeks, you'll hear what it's all about. That's the only response he had. Yet he's the best they have. Dr. Zakir Naik is considered to be the most popular debater today. And if you look at his television show on Peace TV, he speaks English, Arabic, Hebrew, Sanskrit. He also understands, of course, Hebrew and Greek. And he has entire portions of our scripture memorized in his head. And that's why he is so prolific, and that's why he's so dangerous. And he has a rat-a-tat type of delivery where he just takes our scripture and just decimates it. And he's very popular in India. He's from Mumbai, Western Coast. He's a medical doctor himself. He has refused to debate us. I've tried to debate him. I would love to debate him, but he won't debate anybody who can confront Islam. He can confront Christianity, but he cannot defend Islam. And that's his Achilles heel. Adnan Rashid is from here in London. He comes down to Speaker's Corner often. He's down there many Sundays. He and I have engaged with each other hundreds of times. We've had 4 formal debates and many, many, many informal debates. He's fun. He's great. He's a real bully of a guy, large voice, bigger than life personality, and he absolutely gets it. And that's why I love debating him, because he's as radical as you can get. And everything he does, he supports in Scripture. Everything he does, he models on his Prophet Muhammad. Hamza Tsorsis is a Greek convert to Islam. He's one of the primary speakers, very eloquent. He's all over the world. He's now works for IERA, one of their primary speakers. Abdul Green, Rahim Green, is, you've already heard about him earlier. He is a friend of mine many years ago. He would not call me a friend. I call him a friend. English convert, has been the spokesman for the Regent's Mosque and is brought down every once in a while when they get into trouble at Speaker's Corner, but we just run circles around him. When we started working at Speaker's Corner back in 1993, when I started working there, there were about anywhere from 8 to 10 Muslim speakers on 8 to 10 different ladders. Come down to Speaker's Corner next Sunday or any Sunday and see how many Muslim speakers are left. 0. We've pulled down all the speakers, not physically, just because our material is so good. We've taken down all the Muslim speakers, and you'll see why in just a few weeks. This new material that we're going to introduce is one of the main reasons. Abdul Allah Nurlusi, he used to be at Speaker's Corner every Sunday. He's responsible for their Muslim Debate Initiative. He's prolific. He's all over the internet now. He no longer comes to Speaker's Corner. He dare not come down to Speaker's Corner anymore because he's hopelessly inept when it comes to defending Islam. Paul Williams is at Speaker's Corner every Sunday. He was there last Sunday. He'll be there next Sunday. He's very famous on the internet with blogging theology, one of the most eloquent ones, but very, very angry Muslim. He used to be an evangelical Christian, used to be a Baptist, and he has now become a Muslim. But he spends all his time attacking our Bible. He spends no time defending Islam. He can't. He uses it much more as a crutch to attack Christianity. Mansoor Ahmad, have a huge amount of respect for him. Mansoor Ahmad is from Bangladesh. He's at Speaker's Corner every Sunday. He used to get on the ladders. He's been, I think he was at Speaker's Corner even before I started going, over 23 years ago. And he is by far their most prolific speaker when it comes to on the historical, the manuscript evidence. He's one of the primary writers for the Islamic Awareness website, the largest Muslim website in the world today that has the largest treasure trove of manuscript evidence. Very good on that material, but cannot defend it. And you can see just by looking at two debates that he and I had last year, both down at Speaker's Corner for about 2 hours each, one in June and one in September. Go up on our Fander Films website and look at those debates and see how easy it was to not only take down his best arguments, but also use his own website against him, quoting his own scholars. That's how easy this material is. You'll see in about 4 weeks. Zakir Hussain, he also confronts us. He has attacked our theology. He is also from the UK. Have you noticed almost all the best debaters are here in the UK? Isn't that interesting? You've got them all around you. And that's why we need to be aware of who they are. Zakir Hussain would be another one of them. This man is not. Ijaz Ahmed from Trinidad, he's very vitriolic, uses minutiae for almost all his arguments, is much more, though he does debate in America, he tends to spend most of his time on the internet attacking people like myself and others and attacks our person, doesn't really attack our ideas or uses minutiae arguments to get around much larger arguments. Imran Khan out of the Hyderabad, based there, follows dedux tactics, is very much uses ad hominem. They're great at ad hominem. When I say ad hominem, that means character assassination. They attack the person, not the ideas. M.M. Akbar out of Kerala, founder of the Niche for Truth. You can see his material on the internet. And then P.J. Mulavi. I've never met P.J. Mulavi. I've heard an awful lot about him. He speaks in Tamil. He is from Chennai in southeastern India. And he had a following of 1 million followers, was on television for 25 years. One of those prolific Muslim debaters in India. That was until 2 years ago. Sorry, 3 years ago, in 2013, January. I'm going to show you his picture a little later. Tamil Joshua, a friend of mine, challenged him to a debate, a 13-day debate. Now, see, in India, they debate for 13 days. We got pretty much fatigued after 2 hours. But there, they do it for 13 days. And each day, they're going to have a different subject. And the subject the first day, there in January of 2013, was the Bible. He used our material on the historical criticism, ran circles around Mulavi. Now, Mulavi has brought hundreds of Christians to Islam through his television show. He had no answer for any of these criticisms, had nothing, no response. As a result, he had to shut down his television show. All his funding from Saudi Arabia was shut off, and 300 Muslims at that debate gave their life to Jesus Christ because of one debate. I was in India in October, and I met 7 or 8 of them who wanted to see me. They all wanted to come and hug me and give me kisses. I'm not used to guys kissing me here, but they wanted to give me kiss after kiss after kiss, and they kept on showing me their smartphones with all these videos that they had pulled down from our debate site, our Fander Film site. And it was this material, they said, that decimated Mulavi. He did not do a second debate. He could not. All it took was one debate. And it destroyed. And I asked my Indian friends, why is it that one debate had that much damage? They said, you in the West don't understand the power of debates. You haven't really got it here in Europe yet. And the reason why is because you in Europe yet have not really understood Muslim mindset, because you've only known Muslims for about 40 years here. And that's true. We've only really had Islam in a big way here for about 40 years. But in India, we have known Islam for 1,400 years. We've been dominated by Islam. It's the third largest Muslim country on earth. Soon, they say within 20 years, it will be the largest Muslim country. It will now surpass both Indonesia and Pakistan in population, Muslim population. They said for 1,400 years, we've had to deal with Islam, and therefore we have no fear of Muslims at all. You Europeans, you fear Islam. We don't. What's more, they say, we have know that when it comes to Islam, if you debate Islam, for a Muslim, everything is propositional truth. It's based on three things, that Allah is God, Muhammad is prophet, and the final prophet, and that the Quran is the word of God. Those are really all that Islam is based on, those three things. Now, when you attack those three things, is what we do every Sunday at Speaker's Corner, you confront them at those three things. They have nothing to fall back on. See, Christianity is also based that Yahweh is God, that Jesus is the Son of God and has always been the Son of God, and that the Bible is the Word of God. So in some ways, we have Mary's same parallels. But listen, we've had hundreds of debates against Jesus that we have lost. We lose debate after debate after debate. But we don't lose our faith because we all have someone we can fall back onto, a relationship called Jesus Christ. See, Islam has no relationship. They have nothing to fall back onto. If you take out their Allah, if you take out their book, and if you take out their man, you've taken out Islam. They say, you haven't picked that up yet in Europe, have you? Why do you think we have so many debates now in India? And why do 300 give their life to Jesus Christ in just one day? Because they have no idea of a personal Savior. They have nothing to fall back on. It's nothing more than propositional truth based on a lie. Mulavi found that out in January of 2013. So who are the Christian debaters? Who are those who are now standing against them? Now, let's just look at the major players. Dr. James White out of Phoenix. This man is amazing. He has Alpha Omega Ministry. If you want to find any material, just go up on the website and look at his material. This man is prolific, one of the best minds I know. The only problem with him is he loves Reformed theology, and he brings that into every debate. If he could just get off that kick and just stick to Islam, he would do a much better job. But I have a huge amount of respect for this man. The other one is Sam Shamoon. Sam Shamoon is from Chicago. He's an Arminian in background. He is an eidetic memory. That means everything he reads, he memorizes. He forgets nothing that he reads. He's formidable. And you don't want to be on against him or his opponent. He debates an awful lot on television. He does not like any airplanes, so he will not come here. He stays in America for that reason. Unfortunately, he has a phobia of flight. But he is prolific on the ABN channel and also on the Trinity channel. Just look at Sam Shamoon's material. And Answering Islam website has more material up there than anybody else. The guy is prolific. He's an amazing, and he's a good friend. David Wood out of New York is one of our most witty opponents. He is founder of Acts 17, Apologetics 315. He appears regularly on ABN and Trinity Channel. He was an atheist who converted to Christianity and has taken his background as an atheist in the streets of New York and has brought it into his humor as he decimates Islam using humor and witticism. And then, of course, Nabil Qureshi. Nabil Qureshi actually was converted because of David Wood. David Wood brought Nabil Qureshi to Christ. And Nabil Qureshi now is becoming probably our best debater in America. He has written one of the top bestsellers called Seeking Allah, Finding Jesus. If you want one book that you should read, read that book by Nabil Qureshi. He's a friend of mine. We work together. He's now in Oxford University getting his doctorate. He works now with Ravi Zacharias Ministries, who I work with as well in America. And so he is turning out to be one of our best debaters and continue to do so. And then Dr. William Craig. Well, what do you say? What's there to say about Dr. William Craig? There's no other one person in the world that comes close to him. As far as a Christian debater, he's the best we have anywhere in the world. Now, he doesn't debate Islam primarily. He debates the divinity of Jesus Christ. He debates the existence of God. He debates the authority of Scripture. You name it, he debates it. And he never loses a debate. He never loses a debate. And what's most frustrating about him is before he does the debate, he gives his opponent the three things that he's going to say before he even begins the debate so they can attack him at any point. This man has two doctorates, both from Europe, one in the authority of Scripture and the other one in the existence of God. So that's why he's so hard to defeat. Lives in Atlanta. Dr. Michael Licona. In Dallas, USA, Southern Baptist, debates primarily atheists, but he is now moving over and is starting to debate Muslims with us. So we're finally bringing him home to the more important debates. Anna Shoros was a friend of mine many years ago. He is much older, but he is the first one to have debated the Ahmadiyya publicly. And he is the one that got me excited about debates. We became good friends. He's getting old now, but he wrote Islam Revealed and Al-Furqan. He's also in the United States. And then my good friend in Toronto, Dr. Tony Costa. He's really the only debater so far in Canada of note. There are others who are, he's training up. There's a whole team now starting to come out from his tutelage there. He came a few months ago and got up on the ladder with me at Speaker's Corner, and we had a great time together. But a fascinating, fascinating mind. And of course, here in the UK, there's myself, who's been probably done more debates. I've done 80 debates here. For many years, I was the only debater here in United Kingdom. But we're raising up other people like Alan Craig, who is now, how many debates have you done? Three or four? Formal debates and many non-formal debates. So Alan is starting to take on debates. Not only is he taking on the Tub Igligimot, he's also starting to do debates with us. And then, of course, John McClatchy. This is the man to look out for. Here's another man with an eidetic memory. But he's Scottish, so be careful. He has an amazing mind, especially when it comes to science. But he will not stay on science. He goes on to every area. And so we're trying to keep him under control because he is so passionate and he just wants to take on every Muslim that comes down the pike. He just doesn't know the word exhaustion. And then, of course, the women. The ones who have done debates, Beth Grove, who is with us on our team. She's part of the Fander Center of Apologetics. She's the European director. She gets up on the ladder. She'll be up on the ladder in 2 weeks with me. And she is an amazing mind, has her master's in Islamic studies, and has been one of our best spokespeople, though she's a woman. Isn't that amazing? God bless the women in our team, because they are some of the best debaters. And what's fascinating, whenever she gets up on the ladder, the Muslims don't know what to do with her. The men are scared of her, because she runs circles around them when it comes to debating. In the summertime, when she gets up, suddenly all these women that are out there in the parks come running over, and they just come and dominate as they look at this woman up on the ladder. And that symbolism there is as much the gospel as what she has to say. And then, of course, we have probably one of our best debaters is Hatun Tash. She is from Turkey. Her father was an imam himself. She came to Jesus Christ because she fell in love with Jesus and then found out how hopeless Muhammad was. And when she compared the two, she said, I want to come home. Now, this woman has brought 120 people to the Lord in just the last year using polemics. So this idea that you can't use polemics, here's one woman that has done so. She gets up at 4 o'clock in the morning and goes into mosques and just confronts people in mosques, confronts them with the Lord Jesus Christ. She's brought three imams to the Lord. I don't know of any other woman here in Britain who has done as much as she, and yet she breaks every rule, because she goes right into the mosque and says, we're going to talk about the Bible, you're going to talk about the Quran, and I'm going to confront the Quran and show you how great the Bible is. You can talk about Muhammad, but I'm going to show you how great Jesus is. She doesn't have any excuses. She doesn't even make friends. She preaches the gospel everywhere she goes. For her, gospel is first. She was up on the ladder with me on Sunday. She doesn't care how many Muslims see her, because she could be killed. She's an apostate, and yet she has no fear. I've never met a woman like her. She's on our team, and it's been great to use her. And you need to bring her here to speak here at this church, because she will enthuse all of you with her passion for God and for Jesus Christ. Alex Blagojevich, I think I've said that right, he's finding the first one that we have actually in France doing debates, and we're training him up to do debates. I'm sorry, I don't have a picture of him. And Jesse Diggs out of Uganda, who are also training up and trying to take him, because he's the first one to actually do it in North Africa and to take it into Kenya. And he's now starting to train up people in polemics, 4 hours of polemic. 800 Muslims come to his debates. And yet he's had a huge impact there. In South Africa, we have John Gilchrist. He was the first one to actually confront Ahmed Didat and has been probably the best debater confronting the material that he came out with in the 1970s and 1980s. Brian Marion on the left is from India, though he lives in Johannesburg, and he's now a protege of John Gilchrist. Sudhakar Mondekar, now we come to the Indian debaters. This is a man that used to work with Ravi Zacharias Ministries. He dialogues with Muslims. He's now getting into debates with Muslims. And he was the one that hosted us in India last October as we went to 5 cities and spoke to 2,500 young men and women, all about polemics and apologetics and debate. We had our first conference on debates in India, ever done. Never done it before in all my years of 33 years of working with Muslims. And then I met Jerry Thomas, and this guy is prolific. Amazing debater coming out of Mumbai. He has taken all of Zakir Naik's material. Now, Zakir Naik is the one that is considered to be the most popular debater today. Not the best debater, but the most popular debater in the Muslim world. And he has taken all his material and answered every one of his objections. Written them up, put them up in the DVDs, and then challenged Zakir Naik to a debate. And Zakir Naik won't have anything to do with him. He is scared to death of Jerry Thomas. That's why we've got some great men in India who are fearless men, and it's terrific to see what they're now coming up with. Narendra Sahu, who I'm in email contact with every day, he's helping Jerry Thomas. He's also a co-debater with Jerry Thomas. He's also helped him with all this material on Zakir Naik, and they're now challenging anybody in India to debate them, and Indians will not debate them. Muslims just won't debate them because their material is so good. The other one is this man here, and this is the Tamil Joshua I talked to you about. This is the man who decimated the cleric, the Muslim cleric who had 1 million followers, destroyed his material in just one day, all in the Tamil language. That's why we've got some great debaters in India, and this guy I have so much appreciation for. His debate that he did in 2012 and then another one in 2013 are probably going to go down as classical debates. This is a man that I met in Kerala, Telugu speaking. He is the one that's been responsible in the Telugu language for taking and not only taking Mara material, but actually translating it and using it. And now he's training up a whole team of debaters there in Kerala. And then Askar Ali. What can I say about Askar Ali? This guy is Mr. Passion epitomized. If we could have 10 of these guys, we could destroy Islam in one year. He just has such a passion for the Muslims, absolutely loves Muslims, but hates Islam, hates what the Quran is doing to his fellow man. He used to be a Muslim. He's come out of Islam and has nothing good to say about the Quran or Muhammad. And yet he just cries and cries for his Muslim family, for his Muslim friends. He wants so much to bring them to the Lord. And that's why he's now going into debate, a lovely, passionate speaker for Jesus Christ. In Australia, we have two debaters that are now coming up. Samuel Green began as an apologist, moved into polemics, is now the primary debater there in Australia. And then, of course, Dr. Bernie Power, who is on, he is teaching apologetics and polemics there in Australia, but is on staff for the Melbourne School of Theology. Absolutely delightful man to see. He's so winsome and friendly. He's hard to dislike. The Muslims just love him because he makes jokes about everything. And that's why he's such a terrific guy to have on board. Now, if Christianity turns a blind eye, Islam will take over. And that's why we've got to be vigilant. We already see this across Europe, Asia, parts of Africa. The Sharia law that's now being brought in, the parallel legal system that we're now confronting here, Baroness Cox, Alan Craig are confronting it here in the House of Lords and in other places. The Sharia finance that we're seeing, the difficulty that's already happening for the MPs once they move into Richmond House. The properties that Alan's going to talk about next week, the enormous amount of properties that they're buying up. In fact, now the Qatar group own more land in Britain than the Queen does. These are things you need to know about. They have an agenda. They are taking over. The energy supply, Alan's going to talk more about that next week. The aviation control that they have. And of course, the halal meat markets. These are what things we need to go out. But folks, I want to end with this, and I really want to encourage you. Take a look at just those subjects on the screen. These are the seven areas that we can defeat Islam coming and going. These are the areas that we're now zeroing our material on. When you look at these seven areas on both sides, on this side, the Quran, on this side, the Bible. When you look at the Bible versus the Quran, the Bible wins every time. The Bible has had so much more thrown at it, has had so much more on this side, has had so much more criticism. Listen, for 200 years, they tried to destroy the Bible. Ever since the 1800s, in Tübingen, in Germany, with Wellhausen. And the whole school that came up in the 1800s that confronted the historicity, the redacted criticism, source criticism, so that by 1905, the church was decimated here in Europe because of his biblical criticism and Darwinianism. And the church has never recovered in this continent. Now, since 1905, we've done our homework. And almost every one of those criticisms we now have found responses to. Not only did we find manuscript evidence, we found over 5,300 Greek manuscripts, 10,000 Latin Vulgates, 9,000 other languages. That's 24,000 manuscripts we now have been able to amass, that much of them were discovered in the 1800s. And it's those manuscripts that have shown us that we've got the right Bible doing the right thing at the right place with the right time. If you come on our British Museum tour, we just did it yesterday, come and see how much of the artifacts that you all stole and put into that building so we could look at, support and give authority to our Bible. Enormous amount of artifacts in just the British Museum. Supports 1st and 2nd Kings, 1st and 2nd Chronicles, 1st and 2nd Samuel, much of the book of Genesis, much of the book of Jeremiah, also we're finding of the book of Daniel. It's amazing how much support we now have of peoples, places, events, and times. And yet the Quran has nothing like that. We're now destroying the Quran using the same questions that were first voiced back in the 1800s. You're going to hear about that in a few weeks. When you look at Jesus versus Muhammad, there's no comparison. Listen, Jesus wins every time. He's so much more relevant. And take a look and see what we now know about Jesus. Look and see where we not only know where he lived, what he said, we know much about what he did because we have eyewitness accounts. Over on this side, Muhammad, we don't even know what he did. We have no idea where he lived. The city supposedly that he came from has no reference point until 741, yet he died in 632. What book did he put together? What Quran are we talking about? There is no Quran from the same century he lived. We're going to talk more about that. And when we look and see what we now know about the Quran, we find that the Quran was not even finalized for another 200 to 300 years after Muhammad died. We can't find any Quran that is complete, that is perfect, or that even agrees with the Quran we have today from the 7th or the 8th. Or the 9th. In fact, we don't even know when the Quran was finalized. Oh, yes, we do. 1924, less than 100 years ago. The Quran we're using today was canonized in 1924, less than 100 years ago. We'll talk more about that in 4 weeks. When we look at God over on this side, Yahweh versus Allah over here, we're going to spend a whole evening just on that one subject. We're going to look at Yahweh versus Allah, and we're going to show you how hopeless Allah is compared to Yahweh. But more than that, we're going to look at this trend where people are trying to equate those two together, and we're going to ask, why is it that people want to share the same God when there's no way I want to have Allah anywhere over here? I don't want anything to do with Allah. I don't recognize him as my God. He comes nowhere near what I know about Yahweh and the God of the Bible. We're going to look at the kingdom of God and also the Khilafah. And it's the kingdom of God that's fascinating, because when you look at the kingdom of God over here, everything about the kingdom of God comes in contradistinction to the Khilafah over here. And we're seeing what the Khilafah looks like. We're going to talk about it in 2 weeks. ISIS is probably the best example of just that Khilafah. The women in the Bible versus the women in the Quran, no comparison. When you look at peace in Christianity versus the violence of Islam, just take a look and we can unpack that. We're going to show some of it and show you what we're now finding about peace in Islam. It just doesn't exist. And we're going to help you ask Muslims to find that peace that they keep talking about. And then we're going to end with relevancy of both Christianity and Islam. Folks, really, really do have the agenda for today. Yes, Islam is growing. No one doubts that. It's no longer over there. It's very much right here. It's coming to Europe in a very big way. It's certainly coming with these migrations that are now coming that we've seen in the last year. It's going to be even more so next year. And most all of those that are coming our direction are Muslims. Many of them are disillusioned with Islam because of what they've seen with ISIS. And we have to be ready to not only bring them home, but to show that Islam is the problem, not Muslims. Please don't get upset with Muslims. Love the Muslims. They're absolutely the easiest people to love. That's why I've spent 33 years working amongst them. I can't help but love them. They're so passionate, but they're passionately wrong because of one book and one man. We're going to unpack that for you the next few weeks. We're going to help you to understand that. And I hope when you leave at the end of March that you will be able to realize just how great Jesus is, just how great our God is, how hopeless Muhammad is, how hopeless the Quran is, and how we have nothing to do with Allah. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for this evening as we look and see how Islam is coming into Europe and next week as it's coming into Britain, and we see the structures that exist, and we see this enormous religion that's been around for 1,400 years. Actually, it's only been around for about 1,200 years. Yet that religion that has dominated every place it's been, that has moved right across North Africa and moved all the way over into India by the first century and has never given up its land, now is here in a big way, and we need to be able to engage with it publicly. Lord, we want to get beyond that fear that we have of Islam and come back to the gospel of Jesus Christ, because that really is the answer for Islam today. Yes, Islam is growing. Yes, it's coming to Europe. Yes, in the West, we're going to have to engage with it. But we are the best equipped to do so. We are the only ones equipped to do so. This is not something the government can do. This is not something the politicians can do, nor even the clerics of the institutionalized church. This is not even something that the scholars can do, though they have the material. This is only something that radical Christians can do. And those of us sitting here are just the answer for Islam today. As we unpack this material and as we go through, we ask, Lord, that you'll help us in every way to be able to engage at a much, much greater level, but also starting with the Muslims we know, starting with the Muslims in our street, the Muslims in our work, the Muslims in our school, the Muslims who are our friends, those who are absolutely confused by what's happening in the world today. Lord, they need to come home, and there's only one home, and that's with you. May that be our story. May that be our gift to the world. And in everything we say, may we represent you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.